Good morning, everyone. It's such a joy and an honor for us to be here in God's presence once again. Let's all join together wherever we are, and let's just taste what the Lord has done in our lives, the goodness of God. Let us be able to experience it as we praise our Father in heaven. Let's lift our voice together and worship God. Amen.
Rising, rising, say, bursting.
You know, our God is worthy of our praise, our adoration. Every good gift comes from above. And today, it's our chance to give back and say, yes, Lord, you are worthy of it all. So as we lift our hearts, lift our voices, can we declare and say, yes, Jesus, you are worthy of it all.
my Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. In all of my days, and I want to praise the wonders of your mighty
grace. Nothing compares to the blessing that you have bestowed upon each one of us. We just want to lift you up this morning. All the praise belongs to you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, Amen.
Praise the Lord, my dear friends. I hope you enjoyed that amazing time of worship. We just want to welcome you to another episode of Walk Talk, talking about our walk with Jesus. What an amazing thing to walk with the Lord. What an amazing thing to talk about our walk with Jesus. Last week I was talking about the importance of family, how God wants us to protect the concept or the understanding of what family really means. I want you to know that family is not something created by man, but it is something that was instituted by God in the Garden of Eden when He made the first man and woman and was part of the marriage ceremony of both those people. And out of them came all of humanity. And today I want to let you know, think about this. Everything that you are doing wrong, whether you have anger issues, whether you have anxiety, whether you have low self-esteem, it all boils down to your lack of not having a good family structure. Furthermore, I would like to talk about today the impact of fatherlessness in the lives of people. Yes, my dear friends, I want to talk about how important it is to have a father figure in your life. Think about all of the things. If you're a woman, think about, I know so many women who are in wrong relationships, in abusive relationships. Why? Because they have faced abuse when they were a small child. Some of the men, they have lost, not had a father in their life. They don't know what it is to be loved. They don't know how to express love. They don't know how to express love to their family. And what happens when they are fatherless? They take that same fatherlessness, they take that same emptiness, and they go forward and give it forward to the relationship that they are in. Think about that for a second. Think about all the people or that have faced abusive fathers, been hitting them. And what happens? They wind up doing the same thing to their children. Every wrong thing that I see in society today is stemming, at the end of the day, it's stemming from a lack of a stable home. Think of all of the crime that is committed. It's because of lack of a stable home. Look at all of the bad things that are happening in the world. Murder, slander, rape, all of these things. Where is this all stemming from? Where is this kind of a culture? Where is this kind of a thought process even come into a society? When you see small children thrown, begging on the streets at 4 or 5 years old, they don't know what is the love of a family. They don't know what is the love of a father. They don't know what is the love of a mother. They see their father beating up their own mother in front of them. And then what happens? They harden their hearts and they become a replica of their father. Today, I want to talk especially to the men of the house today, to the men of the church. I want to let you know, it is not enough for us to be silent in our home when it comes to God. My dear men, I want to let you know that when you think about holiness, godliness, prayer, and all of these things, when you think about that, always a woman comes to the forefront. I want you to know that I was preaching about the sermon in my church last week where I said, the family is God's, but it's a father's responsibility. Amen. A family is God's, but to run it is a responsibility of a father. It is not good enough for father, for men to just lay back and be lethargic and lackadaisical and be like, oh, I give you some money every month. I'm working all day. I don't have time. But I want to let you know that a man, I'll talk about myself, a man learns how to be compassionate and loving from his mother, but he learns about truth, justice, and righteousness from his father. That is what is missing in men. Lackadaisical behavior, lethargic behavior, behavior that means you can do whatever you want. Oh, I don't have responsibility in the home. I don't care whether my children know God. I don't care. My responsibility is to make money and throw it in your face. If you are a Christian, go to church on Sunday and that's it. No, I want to let you know that you are the voice of God in the family. You are the voice of God in the family. I want to show you many examples, a couple of examples in the Bible. I want to say in Genesis chapter 3, when you think about the evil that was committed by Eve by eating the fruit, read that verse in Genesis chapter 3, verse 9. God comes and says to the man, where are you? He does not say, where are you guys, Adam and Eve? He does not say, Adam and Eve, come together. I want to have a talk with you. He says directly to the man, where are you, Adam? I want to let you know, church, You will be held accountable for the things that you don't do. You will be accountable for the things that you should do, and you will also be held accountable for the things that you do not do in your family. When you do not prioritize God, when you do not prioritize a healthy culture in your home, when you do not prioritize to be a man of the house, not only in showing your masculinity, but saying that me and my household, like Joshua, that we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. I want to let you know, in Nehemiah, Lord, that Nehemiah speaks about in chapter 4, he says that we will fight for our family. When they were building the walls, he said each person needs to stand with his family, and a man should stand in the front. With one hand, he has a weapon, and with the other hand, he was building the walls of the church. Amen. Men, let me ask you, are you willing to fight for your family? Are you willing to open your mouth and say, that will not happen in my house? We will not be doing things that way in my house. We will not be talking like that. We will not be speaking like that. We will not be using language like that. That is not the job of the mother. My dear friends, it is time for men to become what God has called us to be. Hallelujah. The devil is against the family, and the biggest proponent of that is a bunch of men who are unable to live their responsibility as God wills it. And finally, I want to let you know that I love this verse in Joshua 24 verse 15. It says like this: and if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose to this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers that have served in the region and beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But listen to what he finally says. He says to the world, and that's a challenge I want to leave to every man who is hearing my voice. He says, you and your family and your child and your wife and your children can do whatever you want. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. I want to let you know, church, we are not supposed to be, I want you to know that the government is not supposed to be running your family. The government is not supposed to be telling you what to do with your family. It's not run by the government. It's not run by any propaganda. It's not run by culture. It's not run by any caste. It's not run by anything but the Word of God. And today I want to let you know, my dear fellow men, my brothers, my dear uncles, my dear appachens, whoever it may be you may think you are, it's time to take a stand. Hallelujah. And that's what I've been praying for myself, that Father, teach me how to be a man. Not just to exercise my masculinity and put people down, no. But stand for righteousness. Stand for truth. Stand for justice. Stand for good morals and values. And you will see how your family will change. How will our family change, my dear brothers? When we prioritize family, and when the man stands and shows the family what is to be done and how it is to be done. Men don't learn by words. Men learn by actions. You know, my father has never told me what to do, how to do, but I've observed the minutest things that he has shown me through his life. And that's what I want to emulate with my son. I don't want to tell them to love Jesus. I want to show him how to love Jesus. I don't want to tell him that you need to respect women. I need to show him how to respect women. I don't need to tell him how to be a man with good morals and cultures. I need to show him. And you will see, when the man stands up, when you fight for your family, when you start building and defending your family like a godly man should do, you will see that your wife will love you. She will respect you. She will honor you. Your children will love you and respect you and honor you. You know, my father was traveling most of my life, but I saw him. I watched his life in a very, 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 very microscopic level, in the way he used to do things, the way he used to walk, the way he used to talk. And I know for a fact that he did things which were right in the sight of God, which make me today the man that I am. Amen. A godly man will birth forth a godly generation. A godly man will bring forth a godly family, and a godly family will bring blessing and prosperity to the city, to the state, and to the nation, and to the world that we live in. Hallelujah. That's what I want to encourage you today. Stand up and take your place. God bless you all.
Greet you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. It's such a great joy and a privilege for us to come in God's presence and to worship Him and to glorify His name. Friends, our God is a good God. We sing that great song, God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. All the time means every moment of our life, good times and bad times, good job and no job, sadness and happiness, every aspect of our life, we rejoice in His presence because our God is a good God. Amen. We worship our living Savior. We glorify His name. And God has been so good to us. Hallelujah. Worship Him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, with all your strength. That's what Jesus said, love the Lord with everything. We don't keep anything behind, but we will continue to love our God with all our hearts, all our strength, and all our might. Friends, it is a joy to be a worshiper. Worship is not a job. It is not a strain. It is not a hard thing to do. Worship is spontaneous. Worship comes from the depth of our hearts, and we glorify His name. Amen. I want to share with you a message that God has put in my heart. I believe it will be a blessing for every one of us. Let me read a verse from John chapter 8. We'll read verse 32. And this is Jesus saying. And Jesus said, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. I want to abide on this verse and share with you today. You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus Christ was standing before Pilate, and He said the same thing, the truth. And Pilate was saying, what is truth? He did not understand. Here, when Jesus said that you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free, you have to realize that truth is referred here in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus says, I am the truth and the way and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. So truth is a person. Truth is not a philosophy. Truth is not something that you know, you heard, or you believed. Truth is a person. Jesus said, I am the person of the truth. That's what Jesus says. Amen. And the truth shall set you free. Jesus Christ will set you and me free, my dear friends. Amen. When you look at Jude, the Jews were also worshiping Jehovah the Father. But what's the difference between you and a Jew? The difference is this. The Jews were worshiping the Jehovah with so much of fear and awe. That's how they worshipped. Full of fear. It's almost like other religions. Every religion is bringing fear in our hearts whenever they talk about God. Whenever they put up a statue of a god, you can see that all these statues, none of them are good looking. It's all frightening things. Why? Fear is being imposed in our life, and it is connected to God. So they say that anything that you're going to do with God has to be through the fear. But what did Jesus do? But Jesus set us free from the spirit of fear in our relationship with God, and He gave us the spirit of kinship with the Father. We can call Him Abba Father. Praise the Lord. Amen. How does that happen? Because there is a freedom coming, because truth has taken over. Jesus has set you free from the spirit of fear. Amen. This is the first and the foremost freedom that we gain through our Lord Jesus Christ, a personal and a most intimate relationship that you and I can have with our Father God. Amen. We experience the true freedom. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, people say that the knowledge is power. We all have heard it. The knowledge is power. But what's the difference between knowledge and wisdom? Knowledge is power, but wisdom is liberty. Amen. You should know the difference. It's a good thing to have knowledge. And that'll give you the power. Your knowledge will give you the power. But wisdom is more than knowledge. Wisdom gives you the liberty, the freedom. When we know Christ, we become wise and free. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A wise man is far better than a man full of knowledge. Amen. That'll only lead you to having so much of power within yourself. But there's no freedom attached to that. Only wisdom will give you the freedom. And only Jesus Christ can do that for you. Amen? The truth also sets us free from the law of sin and death. There's a law. Everyone who commits sin will die. There's a law of sin and death. But Jesus Christ gives us the freedom from the law of sin and death. How? Because we are given eternal life when we know Christ. We are free from the power of the sin and death. Amen. We are free from the power of sin and death. Listen to me very carefully. But we are not free from the presence of sin in this world. Sin is always there. But God has broken the power of sin, the power of death from our life, through the freedom that Christ gives us, through the truth that He has given to us. The presence of sin will be always with us as long as we live in this earth. Amen. We are also free from the penalty of sin. The penalty of sin is not only death in this world, it is an eternal death. But the truth is setting us free from the penalty of sin. We are freed from the fear of death. We are freed from the fear of failure. Are you listening to me? What are the freedom that you and I enjoy in our life? Listen carefully, my dear friends. We are free from the fear of sin and death, from the power of sin and death, but not from the presence of sin. Remember that all the time. Sin is always lying at the door. That's what God said to Cain. The sin is lying at the doorstep. The presence is always there. But God has set us free from the penalty of sin. And let me see this, friends. We are free from the fear of death. We are free from the fear of failure. We are free from the curses. We are free from the fear of the future and the fear of the unknown things in our life. People are so frightened of the unknown things. Things which we do not know whether it will happen. What will happen to me? We are so frightened of things that we don't even know which could ever happen. But Jesus Christ, the truth, is setting you and me free from all these things. Let me say that again, my dear friends. Remember this. Free from the power of sin and death. Free from the fear of death. Free from the fear of failure. We're all living in that. Failure is haunting us. We always think that we'll fail. We worry about that all the time. Fear of curses. Somebody curses you and you're frightened. You know, they put a curse on me. They brought a witch doctor. And he put a curse on my family. My business is going down. There is sickness in my house. There's so much of trouble going on in my house because of the curse that is put on me. No, no. Listen to me, my dear friends. You are freed from the curses. You are freed from the failure. God is taking away even the fear of your future. Parents worry about the future of their children. They worry about their studies. They worry about what they will become of. No. Jesus Christ said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free." Hallelujah. Amen. The most important thing is knowing the truth, my dear friends. Most important thing is knowing Jesus Christ. I ask you today, do you know Jesus Christ? How much do you know Him? What kind of a relationship that you have with this Jesus Christ? Ask yourself, you may be even a believer. You may be a Christian for years. But what is your relationship with Jesus? Do you know that you are free? Many people, many Christians are still living in bondage. They don't enjoy the freedom of Christianity. But Jesus is time and time again saying to us, "Hey, I am the truth. I am the life. I can set you free." When the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Hallelujah. Amen. Learn to trust in Jesus Christ. Learn to walk with Jesus Christ. Learn to enjoy the freedom. That's so important for you and me, my dear friends. And He will set us free from all these things that we are struggling in our life. Struggling all the time in our life, my dear friends. The Lord wants to set you free and me from all these problems and difficulties. That's the first freedom. The most important freedom that we enjoy is taking away the fear, even the fear of God in our life, like Jews worshiping with fear and awe, because that's the only thing that they knew. They did not have a sweet and loving relationship with Jesus, with God, which came through the Lord Jesus Christ. God wants you to have that in your life. Amen. And the second freedom is that we are freed from our shortcomings and even in our being, in our thoughts, feelings. And God is saying, God wants you to be free. We are free to pursue perfection in our life. That's what God wants from us. But we are not free. We're always struggling in our life. The second freedom is we are free from all our shortcomings. We're always putting us down. We always say, "I'm no good." It may be good for him. It may be good for her. They are better than me, but I'm not good. We are living on our shortcomings. We are living on our weaknesses. But the Lord is saying to us today that you can pursue perfection and to excel in all these areas. Let me say that one by one. What will you excel in your life? In your spiritual life. In your intellectual life. Sometimes we think, I'm not fit for this. I can't think straight. I'm not wise. I'm not intellectual. Those people are so good. They can understand things. But today the word of the Lord is coming to you through the truth that Jesus Christ is giving you, is that He's freeing you from all your shortcomings and your thoughts and feelings within your heart. So, you will excel in your spiritual things, in your intellectual things, in your emotional things, in your social things, in your professional things. And the Lord says, when I give you the freedom, you'll enjoy the freedom in all these areas. Amen. Whenever the people are blessed, what do they say? They will say something like this. You know, somewhere along the line in my life in the past, I must have done something good and it has come upon me. And on the other way, when things are not going well for you, what will you say? You'll say, you know, somewhere in the past, I must have done something which is not right, and now I'm paying the price for it. Is that what you're saying? But I want you to know, my dear friends, that you and I have no control over our lives. If you do something good, and a blessing comes because of that, you do something bad, and some bad things, curses comes upon you, then you become the controller of your life. That's not God's plan. And I want you to know, your life is not based on karma. It is not based on works. It's based on the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. God is in control of your life and of my life. Amen? That is the second freedom that we enjoy because of the truth that God has given to us. Let me look at the third freedom that the truth can give us. The third freedom is we are given the freedom to study and apply the law of liberty from the Word of God. Word of God gives us the freedom. Praise the Lord. The Word of God is truth. Truth will reveal verse by verse through the Word of God. Every word, every precept, every ounce of the Word that the Bible teaches you is based on the truth. And it gives us the truth, gives us the law of liberty. The Word of God brings us truth in our life. It teaches us the things that we need to understand. The Word of God shows us the way. The Word of God sets us free because the God's Word is the truth. Amen. That will set us free. We are free from our anxieties. We are free from our worries. And the Lord frees us through His Word. Amen. Hallelujah. Your anxiety, we read that. The Bible says, do not be anxious of anything. Do not worry about things. Worry will kill you and me. Worry will lead us to depression. Anxiety will lead us to depression. But the word of the Lord says, don't be anxious of anything, but rather give thanks unto the Lord for everything, because God has given us the freedom through His Word. Do you read God's Word? Is it that small chapter that you read so quickly and run away to your job in the morning? Have you read the Bible completely at least once in your life? Have you seen the great treasures in the Word of God? Have you done that in your life, my dear friends? The Word of God is life. The Word of God is truth. I want to encourage you today. Be a reader and the doer of God's Word. Study the Word of God. Let the law of liberty come upon you. Let the Word teach you the way that you should walk. How? Not walking in anxiety, not living in worry, but enjoying liberty and freedom. That's what the Word of the Lord will give to you and me in my life. Amen. Amen. The fourth freedom is the freedom that the Holy Spirit will give us. Amen. The indwelling Spirit of God will give us the freedom in our life. When the Holy Ghost lives in your heart, when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, what does He do to us? So many things the Holy Spirit will do. He is a comforter. He is the Spirit of truth. He will give us the power. He will give us the strength. The Holy Spirit will bring a new freedom in ourselves. The Holy Ghost will give us joy. The Holy Spirit will give us peace. And giving us, moment by moment, happiness and joy in our life. Amen? And the Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Liberty. I'm about to finish my message, my dear friends. That is the fourth freedom that we are enjoying. God gives us the Spirit, the indwelling Spirit of God, will give us the joy and peace. And He will lead us moment by moment. And He will lead us in truth, in spirit of liberty. That's what He will do to us. Amen. This truth will set us free. Amen. But I want you to know, my dear friends, the freedom is a process. You know, like we think like this, the truth has set me free. It just happened one moment. No. It's a process of knowing the truth. And being set free is a lifelong process. It happens one day. And the process continues on. Because the truth that you and I enjoy will give us the liberty, will lead us and guide us, will strengthen us. His power will be upon our life. Remember this. It's not a one-day process. It's a lifelong process. But it's towards enjoying the fullness of the truth that comes in Jesus Christ. Four things I want you to remember. The freedom that Jesus gives us. Freedom, that is our relationship with God. Freedom from sin and death. Fear of death. Fear of future and all those things. And number two, freedom from our shortcomings. Freedom from our karma. Putting us down, saying that something I've done wrong. But God says your life is in my control. That's the second freedom. The third freedom is the freedom of liberty through the Word of God. And the fourth one is the Holy Ghost. Why don't we begin enjoying the freedom, living the life of truth which God has given to us, and God's name be glorified. God bless you with this word. Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for this great truth that is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Help us to enjoy every freedom that comes through the truth and make it a part of our life, Lord. Make it a blessing for every one of us. We give you the praise and glory. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. God bless you, my dear friends. The truth shall set you free.